talking about?
Confidence.
Boy, y'all said that with a lot of confidence. What am I teaching on?
Confidence.
Thank you. You got to talk confidence to get confidence.
Amen.
You may not always feel confident. That doesn't mean you don't talk confident. I learned long ago, I've taught Clarice, I taught all my children, never let them see you sweat. And never allow the enemy, remember he can't hear what you're thinking.
Amen.
But he does hear what you say.
Amen.
He goes by what you say and how you act, and that determines whether he's getting to you or not. Now, why would he want to take confidence? Because of fear.
Amen.
This world now is consumed with fear.
Amen.
And a majority of it is fear of failure.
Yeah.
We're really fearing it, and we don't even know what we're fearing. But we're fearing anyhow.
Amen.
Fear, I'll go back to jail. I fear I'll be broke. I fear I'm going to lose my car. I fear they're going to turn off the lights. I have fear somebody's going to break in my house. People right now are in fear because of government shutdown. The devil has constantly in this last 10 years, used fear to really hold the human hostage.
Amen.
We don't talk to people because we're afraid of who they are and what they might do. Fear is running rampant, and fear is a demon. Fear is a spirit.
Amen.
Fear is more than just an emotion. Fear is a spirit.
Amen.
So when fear comes to someone, it is a spirit from the enemy fearing I'll never be married. Fear nobody will want me. Fear I won't get into college. Fear has become, especially since 9/11 in this country, fear is a major component. Everybody's afraid. And it's a trick of the devil to kill your confidence or your faith in what God has said to you.
Amen.
When you have faith equals confidence. If you don't have any faith, you don't have any confidence.
Amen.
You cannot have confidence and not have faith in God.
Amen.
And I've already taught you, if you got confidence in you, you got confidence in family, you got confidence in friends, well, here's a wake-up call. You're going to be let down.
Amen.
You're going to be disappointed because human beings, you've let people down.
Amen.
Human beings let each other down. Your confidence cannot be in something so weak as a human.
Amen.
The Bible says put your confidence not in man, but in God.
Amen.
If you don't have confidence in God, then you fail.
Amen.
You fall every time. You've got to put your confidence in what God says.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We live where, I mean, there's so much going on. Confidence will cost you. Because confidence, you have to fight for it. Because if you lose your confidence, you lose your faith. And so, the devil works constantly to rob you or steal your confidence.
Amen.
That's his job. And he's good at it.
Amen.
We gotta give him his props. He already knows he's good at it.
Yeah.
He's caused people to backslide. He's caused people to sin. He's caused people to lose. He's caused so many things out of fear.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Fear. You know, you get your third notice. The lights are gonna be turned off. So you go out of fear and do something that you shouldn't do. But because you're being pressed by fear, if you don't fight it, then it consumes you, just like that. And the thing about fear is you don't even know that fear is doing it until maybe after the fact, or you may never realize that you're operating in a modus operandi called fear. Parents will do it to children out of fear. So the devil is, the Bible says he's the slickest thing on earth, and he is. And so what the devil doesn't want you to do is get teachings like this.
Amen.
Because now you're waking up, your spirit man is going, yeah. You're becoming aware that if you really contemplate, look at your life, you will see many times when you operated in fear.
Amen.
Instead of in faith. And so you showed the devil and you showed God, I have no confidence in your word. Well, you didn't have confidence because you didn't realize you were operating in fear and not in faith. And the Bible says you perish for a lack of knowledge. So because you don't have knowledge of that fear, it's really the spirit that is talking. Your thoughts are coming from fear.
Amen.
Your mind is really prone to what it sees and what it hears.
Amen.
And so fear operates in that realm. If you don't have the word that, okay, this is fear. You haven't been taught, this is fear. Can't deal with this. I got to stand in faith. Then you give in to fear.
Amen.
Thoughts like, well, you're this age and you ought to have this and that. And you don't have this and that, so you need to do this and that. That's fear. I don't know who sets up what you should have and what you shouldn't have. And I haven't read that book yet. That at this age, you should have this, and this, and be doing this, and this. But that is pushed on us to make us lose our confidence.
Amen.
Because you become discouraged.
Amen.
You become depressed. Y'all not hearing me.
Amen.
Abraham was in his 70s when God called him.
Amen.
Moses, when he began to preach, he was already in his 90s. In America, the world itself now dictates through media and print who we should be and where we should be in life.
Amen.
And so we'll go in debt because society through media says I should have this kind of car. I remember one time Bishop wanted, I forgot the name of it, it's Chrysler 300 something. And he really, 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 really wanted that car. Anybody who was a preacher was going in debt. Excuse me. No, I'm talking about the box car. You want it. Whatever that was, the name of it. And anybody who was everybody had that car. Right after, almost right after, and black preachers, everybody was driving this, I think it's a 300.
Quite a 300.
Everybody was driving. And if you were a preacher, worth anything, and you were blessed, then you had a Chrysler 300. See, it's ridiculous sounding now, but at the time that the enemy brings it, it makes sense. And it brings pressure because we have not built up our confidence muscles in God. And so we're trying to impress human beings and trying to prove or solidify, I'm called to preach because I got a 300. When really that car has nothing at all to do with who God has called you to be.
Amen.
You could be driving a hoopty from 1968 if it's still working.
That's right.
And if you're called to preach, you're a preacher.
That's right.
Take business. You may start a business. If you don't have the truck or the right, say you're in an office business, a business, and you pull up in a hoopty. You don't pull up in a Mercedes E. Or a Jaguar, or an Audi, you pull up in a hoopty. You're still in the 1968 hoopty. When you get out, if you have confidence in God, your suit may have come from Goodwill. See, this is my mentality. It doesn't matter.
Amen.
Who knows it came from
That's
Goodwill?
Right. That's right.
I went to the $1.99 set cleaners. I got it clean. I got me a tie from Goodwill and a nice white crisp shirt. and I'm looking good.
That's right.
Amen.
I'm looking good, and I get out my hoopty, shake my neck, get my briefcase I got from Salvation Army store, and I go in the door.
Amen. Amen.
If I listen to this,
yeah,
where the devil is talking, I'm not going to go like this. I'm going to go. And I've already convinced myself, you ain't going to get this job. You ain't going to get this contract. You know, you got on a Goodwill outfit and shirt and tie. You're not going to get it. I'm not going to get it yet. Because things are possible, Mark 9:23, to them that
believe.
You have got to believe in the God inside of you that believes in you.
Amen.
And you cannot do that based on people, places, or things. Because if you live in a realm of confidence, you've got to understand you're not going to have a whole lot of people on your side.
That's right.
Amen.
You're not. People say I'm arrogant, they'll call me a bee, they say she thinks she cute, which I do. Unless you think highly of you,
that's right.
Amen.
Nobody else is going to do that.
Amen. Right.
So what will happen is you'll walk around making, I used to do this, people say, oh, you look nice. I say, oh, you think so in this thing? That's lack of confidence. And believe it or not, people like that. They'll feed on it. They will literally, like piranhas, eat you apart because you have let them know you're sweat.
Uh-huh.
Look at somebody and say, never let them see you sweat.
Never let them see you sweat.
You have got to talk to you.
Amen.
When I worked in executive level, out in the business world, they used to give us cassette tapes to tell you how long this was. And you had to listen to them. They wanted you to listen to them on your way to work, listen to them on your way home, listen to them before you went to bed. And all they did was say things like, you are great, you have confidence, you can do this, there's no defeating you, all you got to do, and then we use terms like believe. Believe that you can do it, and you can do it. It doesn't matter what it is. Doesn't matter how it comes. Doesn't matter what to say. And by the time it finished, you just felt like Rocky, man. And they did that to build the executives' confidence. You have got to talk to you.
Yeah. Yeah.
You remember when David went out to battle?
Yes.
And after he had won all this stuff for folk, this is how people are. You can do for folk forever, and folk will turn on you on a dime.
Right.
So if your confidence is in people, you're going to fall, man. You're going to fail. Because you're constantly trying to prove something to people. I'm not trying to prove nothing to nobody.
Yeah.
I'm trying to serve God and people. I really don't. And people get upset at this. People don't like it. And some people tell me, I just don't believe it. I said, that's fine. That's on you. It's my life. I really don't give a flip what people think.
Amen.
I care what God thinks of me.
Amen.
I really don't care. And what I found out was when people really realized I didn't care what they thought, they got mad.
Amen.
So I went back to God and said, God, why are people mad? And he said, because they can't control you.
Amen.
They can't manipulate you based on how they react to you or what they say or don't say to you. It don't matter to me if you'll never speak to me.
Amen.
It really don't. I'm going to say, hey, and I'm going to keep right on going.
Amen.
It does not matter.
Amen.
And when you get to that place that it's about God, what does the word say about me? How am I supposed to live? How am I supposed to be? Now, this is how I think. You don't like me, you're missing out on a great treat.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. That's how I think. Who she thinks she is. Thank you. I don't think. I know who I am.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
People live all their life trying to figure out, what was I born to do? Who am I?
Yeah. Yeah.
Failure comes from fear.
Failure
comes from hurt and fear. They hook up to, remember I taught you demons hook up together.
Uh-huh.
The devil will use people,
places, and things
to bring fear and bring hurt, and then he builds on it.
Yeah.
Just like you build a house. That's the foundation.
Amen.
And people spend their whole, could start in childhood, and people will spend their whole life on that foundation. And they never realize, I'm dog chase tail. I'm just, and they keep coming back to the same place, but then they make reasons and excuses.
Amen.
It's always somebody else's fault that I'm not successful. No, it's your fault.
Amen.
I don't care what is going on in your life. Here's the word, forgive and forget it.
Amen.
You know, like in New York, get over it. You know, just let it go.
Amen.
Because you're not really hurting anybody but you.
Amen.
Because whoever hurt you has gone on about their business.
Amen.
Trust me. And if you go back to them, they'll probably say, what you talking about?
Uh-huh.
I don't remember that. But now you're hurt more because you were so drastically hurt. You thought they were hurting too, and they should realize how much they hurt. People don't care that much anymore. This is what I say. If you hurt me, then you didn't care nothing about me.
Yeah.
It's just that simple. And I will allow, notice I used the word allow. I will allow myself to cry for a bit. Y'all better hear me.
Amen.
I get angry for a bit.
Amen.
And I get upset for a bit, and then it's to hell with it.
Amen.
I make my brain do that. Because I refuse to live less than what God has for me.
Amen.
Based on somebody else's stupidity.
Amen.
Because it's stupid. If for me, or you to be in a, or because somebody did something to you.
Yeah.
You know, people be talking, they 80 years old, they talking about what their mama did, what their father did. Okay, they did it.
Yeah.
I never met my father. My mother lied to me about my last name. My stepfather mother and my real mother changed my last name. I didn't even know I had a real dad outside of the dad that I still consider my dad, till I was 16 years old. I could use that man and ride that train till he put me in the grave. Because according to society, I'm supposed to have low self-esteem, I'm supposed to have lust demons looking for my father figure. I'm supposed to be sad, I'm supposed to be mad. I ain't got time for that.
Amen.
Amen.
Go to Proverbs 28:1, and then I'm going to show you something. And you don't have time for it.
Man.
You have to get to the place where you say it's time to move on. It used to be a song when I was young by Teddy Pendergrass. Young people probably don't even know who that is. We used to call him Teddy P. And he said, it looks like another TKO. I think I better let it go. Let it go. Looks like another TKO. He had more sense than we do. You know, I can't go back and sit on my mom's lap. My mother was not a nurturing woman. My mother was, I am sure the little bit I know about her childhood, her mother didn't want her and didn't raise her, her grandmother raised her, and a lot of things that I know. And then she went in the military. Mom just wanted a huggy, huggy, kissy, kissy person. So I never got to sit on my mother's lap. My mother never hugged me. I was 36 years old before I heard her say, I'm proud of you. I could use it, man. Just like anybody else. Everybody got plenty of stuff they could use for an excuse for bad behavior, meanness, hatefulness, and failure.
Amen.
Well, I'm living like this because. And because what? Because you want to. You're comfortable there. You're like a homeless person. When they stink, they don't even know they stink anymore.
Right.
They can't smell their own. You can't even smell your own funk before God. God's talking about, look, I got blessings. I sent my son that you might have life
and
have it
more abundantly.
And that term more abundantly means, what did I tell you? To the overflow. I sent my own son, my only child, to do that for you, and you sitting there whining. So you don't have confidence in God. You have confidence in people, places, and things. And you're enjoying. There are people who enjoy suffering. And they want other people to suffer around them.
Amen.
And they get very upset when you're happy and you're confident. People get upset when I talk like this.
Amen.
Amen.
She can't be the comment. Why not?
Yeah.
Why not? The same way you can be depressed and discouraged. And another thing fear does, it creates people who are distant.
Amen.
Sure will.
Amen.
It creates people who don't want nobody in my business. It's just me and my four and no more.
Mm.
I don't know what they're going to do. You're really afraid that people are going to see the real you and not like you.
Amen.
You're afraid. You're afraid. And someone like myself, I'll look and I'll see the demon of fear. Praise the Lord, Pastor. How are you? God, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah, okay. And I feel sad for you. They don't even know that he's got them like this, when they could be like this. God is not going to give you the blessing that he really wants to give you until you get to the place he wants you to give. I've told you 50 million times, God does not give a Mercedes blessing to a 10-year-old mindset.
Amen.
Little kids get afraid at an environment. They used to, I don't know if they still do, they would give these stickers. Said, put it on the window where the child sleeps. In case there's a fire, we know there may be a child in it. Because when children are afraid, they'll crawl up. They'll go in a closet. They'll go under a bed. I tell staff here all the time, do not leave the food pantry door open. Kids will just go in there, curl up, go to sleep. You'll be looking everywhere for them. When we do van, we look up under the van, around the van, because they can curl up under the van and go to sleep. And you think you dropped them off, but you didn't drop them off. They in the van sleep.
Yeah.
That's fear. Fear. And fear will do that to adults. And they're living every day of their life, but they're not letting nobody in, and they ain't coming out. They're not doing the will of God, the work of God. They're not doing nothing, but they're functioning. They're functioning. They're functioning, but they're disabled. But they're functioning. Let's read this scripture. The wicked flee. See, I just said that. With no man pursuing, but the righteous are bold as a lion. You've got to understand this. Hear me. Please hear me. Fear will use 1% truth, which the devil always does, and wrap it in 99% lie. Okay? Roosevelt said, the only thing you have to fear is fear itself. You've got to face what it is.
Amen.
That's right.
If you don't face it with confidence, it will come around again. Bring up the flogging, Tigna, and kill the lights. I still got lights. But you're trying to do that. That's correct. The wicked flee when no man pursues. There ain't even nobody after you, but you run. Because you went fear. You didn't see this.
The prisoner is to be flogged before the entire regiment.
Now, what's that? Excuse us, Sergeant Mulcahy.
Your pleasure, Colonel.
Remember, we're talking about
never
fear.
Never question my authority in front of none.
You be the boss man now, and all us chillens must learn.
Major Ford, stand at attention.
Sergeant Mulcahy, You may commence.
Who had the fear? Who has the confidence? Confidence, there is no faith. You gotta believe that God is going to do it. God did something yesterday. We showed y'all that are faithful and come to church. I think it was the Thursday night. We showed you the pictures of the mobile units we were trying to buy. Amen?
Amen.
And we were torn between, do we build on the back? Amen, Sister Cheryl? Mm-hmm. Or do we buy these units? Mm-hmm. Well, and being prepared for Deacon Williams, he's out of town. We priced it, Deacon Williams said the minimum will be $40,000. The minimum. Mm-hmm. To build those 6 classrooms on the back. He said probably much more, but at a minimum, $40,000. And that's with the men doing the labor. Supplies, wood, wire. Insulation is very high right now. Everything's high. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all awake or y'all asleep?
We're awake.
Okay. So, almost like the flogging scene, the devil was beating against my mind. Because we have grown with students. And I've got classes, especially in the back, Sister Samantha's classes, Tyler needs to move out. Sister Riddick's class is growing. Sister Tyler's class is growing. Sister Riddick's people make a lot of noise. I had to put Sister Cheryl back there the other day because Sister Riddick, I think, had a doctor's appointment, whatever. And she said, well, I'll handle it. She's supervisor, that's what you do, you fill in. She came in my office, her shirt was hanging. I'm serious, this part of her shirt was out, her hair was all messed up, and she fell in the door at me and said, Pastor, I can't take much more of this. And I said, what's wrong? She said, them kids, man, my hat is off to Missionary Riddick. I don't know how she's doing, but them kids back there are terrorists. Look at me, Pastor. I'm wore out. I can't take any more. I came out for a break. I just came over here to get a piece of air, Pastor. I just got to get out of here. And they are truly that way. They are the crazy threes. Since Tyler's trying to educate at a whole different pace, the four-year-olds, they're at desks, and we transcended our four-year-olds. And the noise, and she doesn't complain or say anything, but every time I go back there, I go, and the enemy says, How you gonna tell people you're giving a good education? How you giving a good education and they got all this learning? How the 4-year-old's gonna learn with them? Just bombarding me. Then the lunchroom, the fellowship hall is too small now. So we've gone to 3 lunch times to make sure all the kids get fed. So I need, he says, see, you need a bigger, every day this was happening. You need a bigger lunchroom, and you don't have the money, and you don't have this, and you don't have, and look at the children, and they don't credit that. And then poor Deacon Allen, she's not poor, she's rich. Rich Amen. Deacon Allen, see, I'm learning to watch what I said. Rich Deacon Allen is serving 3 lunch hours and trying to keep up. Okay, what time is it? All right, this is the first shift. I got the second shift coming out. I got the third shift coming out. And she's back. She's like, and so I'm saying, see, you need to hire more people. But right now you can't hire more people. And then you need more room. And where is your God? Why would your God, this one I know it's him, why would your God be sending all these kids and you don't have no space? And why would your God hold up, because that bitch and I talked the other day, and I said, I'm not doing nothing. I haven't heard from God. Now, my mind is experiencing anxiousness from the devil. Y'all hearing me? In my mind, I'm fighting because I'm going to have confidence. But I'm looking around at what I see, and I'm going, all I have to do, what the devil wants me to do is say, where are you? Why aren't you doing anything? You're not helping us at all. And for all these kids, and I don't have nobody's but all these kids, and you're in them, and you're, and you're, see, this is what you go through. But you've got to remind yourself of what God said. Same thing about I'm this age, and I don't have this, and so what? Who said that's what you're supposed to have?
Come on.
Remember all the people that bought houses?
Yeah.
Shouldn't have had houses because they couldn't afford houses. But there was a time everybody and their mama was buying a house, no money down to the house, and they done lost them. They're struggling to hang on to them. So maybe God didn't want them to have a house right then. Maybe God wanted them to wait. So I'm going through this flogging. The devil's flogging me. I'm looking around. I told Bishop the other day, I said, you know what? I'm not doing nothing. I was really talking to the devil. I said, I'm not doing nothing. Because I haven't gotten that. And you may not yet be at the point in your growth in Christ to know what I'm talking about. But there is a, and you know that, you know Amen. That's God.
Yes.
I said, I don't know what I'm doing. Right now, I ain't gonna do nothing. And I come in the next day, and the 3-year-olds are off the chain. Sister Tyler's over there trying to teach. The lunchroom is packed. Rich Deacon Allen is running back and forth. Sister Cheryl needs to get out of the classroom that's in the fellowship hall. So I shift her over there. When the little people come out, y'all go in there and have a class. So you can have a class till it's your shift. And we're just... So, yesterday... So you get the flogging?
Yeah.
Anybody else experience that?
Amen.
When you've asked God to do something... And then nothing has happened yet?
Amen.
Good. Then I'm talking to the 4 or 5 that answered. I'm doing okay. So yesterday, we had set up to go to Enrico's Public School Salvage Sale. That's where they sell things that they don't want to use anymore in their schools. Richmond doesn't do that anymore, and neither does Chesterfield. But Enrico's still holding on. So we called over there. They had plenty. I need a desk. Sister Samantha's class needs some more desks. So I said, I'm going to go over there and I'm going to buy about 20 of them. You know, and just put them in storage because I'm going to need them. Where am I going to put these 20 kids? I don't know. I've moved her into 2 sides of classroom now. That's how her class has grown. Where am I going to put 20 desks? I don't have room. We don't have room for another desk in here, do we?
Maybe one more.
So, but in faith, that I'm going to have more space. And I'm confident, so I'm going to go out and buy 20 desks for $3 a piece. I'm like, wow, that's a good deal. No, don't clap yet, brother. By the time I get there, it's sold out. I'm discouraged. I'm pissed off, okay? And I'm not going to go into why I'm pissed off, but I'm pissed off. And a man says to me, well, if y'all had got here a little earlier, you could have gotten. You can't show up at this time of the morning and expect those desks to be here. It had not been a good morning anyway. And then the devil is, that's the devil. Do you understand what I'm saying? People,
places, and things.
The place was in Michael Salvatore. The thing is the death, and the people is this man.
Yeah.
He's almost scolding me. So I'm like, yeah, okay. Holy Spirit said, don't open your mouth. Don't open. So you got to be in tune. That's why you got to build up your spirit, man, for when the test comes.
Oh, yeah.
Because the test is coming because the devil sees something.
Oh, yeah.
Y'all better learn that.
Yeah.
The devil sees something. And he has to get you to do or say something to cut into that. So I put my tongue in my teeth and I didn't say anything. I want to say a whole lot, but I ain't saying nothing. So I saw some tables. We needed, believe it or not, some more folded tables, so I bought them real cheap. And we brought the big trailer out and everything for these things. So we're going home, and I was coming back here. I'm going to say, ooh. But the Holy Ghost, all he's saying to me is to open your mouth. But before we leave, this same man, he's the only black guy that's been over there for the 10 years we've been going over there. He comes over to me. He looks around. Y'all know why he looked around. Because it was all white people here. And he comes up to me. He said, did they give you my card? Because I told him at the front to give you my card. Because I told him, I said, well, I guess I need to call to find out if you have the desk. He's here. But that wasn't why he told them to give me the card, but they thought that was why. So Bishop's backing up the trailers to get the tables off the dock. And he comes to that website. Go to that website. I go, so I go to the website, and I'm trying to figure out how to work it. And you have to put in the locality you want. So I put in Richmond. Two dumb things came up. I said, and the devil said, see, this is going to be a waste of your time. This is just a waste of your time. So I said, well, let me put in Chesterfield. Just see what they have. No desk. But as I was scrolling down, are y'all paying attention?
Amen.
I see mobile homes. And I look and I go, not mobile homes. The thing says mobile classrooms for sale. Wow. I went. Because when I look over at the bid, they auction stuff, the last bid was $110 for two.
Wow.
I'm going. Something ain't right. But the devil said, you know they're just going to be shacks and shabby for that price. Because remember, the last price we got for two for Mobile Solutions was $35,000.
Mm-hmm.
And $2,500 of that was to move it. And she was saying, you need 18 tires and you need this and you need that. And then they got to put the footing in and all the stuff. So I just knew. But I didn't know. Because I was confident.
Mm-hmm.
You don't hear me.
Amen.
So even though I knew it wasn't going to be nothing, I'm still going to be confident. And go to the next video. It's our time. Amen. me sound. Little more sound.
Yeah, button up that collar. Something that good.
Little more sound.
And them big black lips. Lighten your skin. Shrink up that nose.
See, whenever you're trying to better yourself, only people make fun of you.
Where you going, boy?
Let you buy.
Let you buy. Let you buy. Let me tell you something, boy. You can march like the white man. You can talk like him. You can learn his songs. You can even wear his suits. But you ain't never gonna be nothing to him but an ugly ass chimp in a blue suit. Oh, you don't like that, do you?
No. Mm-hmm. Or real cookie.
But what are we gonna do about it? You want to fight me, boy? Huh? What you gonna do about it?
That's what he's calling.
You want to fight me, don't you? Don't you?
Off me, the whole world got a stomp in your face, Timmy. You better get your hands off me.
Ain't no niggas around here, you hear me?
Oh, I see. So the white man give you a couple of strikes. Next thing you know, you hollering, ordering everybody around like you the master yourself. Nigga, you ain't nothing but the white man's dog.
Shit. What are you? Some full of hate, you just want to go out and fight everybody. Or you've been whipped and chased by hounds. Well, that might not be living, but it sure as hell ain't dying. And that is what these white boys have been doing for going on 3 years now. Dying by the thousands. Dying for you, fool. I know because I dug the graves. And all the time I'm digging, I'm asking myself when, oh Lord, it's going to be our time. But time's coming when we're going to have to ante up. Ante up and kick in like men.
Like men!
You watch who you call a nigger. Then the niggas around here is you. Smart mouth, stupid ass, swamp running nigga. You ain't careful, that's all you ever gonna be. You been going back to business.
That was good. When you're right at the tip of being successful, be careful who talks to you. Careful who comes around you. He was picking at that guy because that guy was an educated guy who decided he wanted to fight. He wanted to help. Because blacks back then thought they were fighting for freedom. And that the real issue we know was money. Blacks were free labor. It wasn't really about everything we've made it about now. It was about the fact that they had us working and didn't pay us. And that made them rich. It really comes back down to greed of money. All the other stuff piled on, I'm not saying it didn't happen or didn't exist. I'm talking to the intellectual person, the educated person. It really in this country is always about money. Always. The issue is though, you will come up against people who don't understand what you're trying to do and what you're trying to be. And if you're not careful, people call me Oreo cookie all night. I got to the point, I don't even care anymore. I really don't. You want to say I'm black on the outside, white on the... Isn't it a shame that somebody that's educated, running businesses, successful businesses, that you say that's acting like white? Why? Because I don't talk that street talk. I'm acting like I'm white. We call things of class and culture the white folks stuff. Why? I don't see anywhere where class, education, and distinction is for white people only.
Amen.
Right. That's right. That's right.
It's the mentality.
So
I looked at this mobile building, said classroom, and I said, wow. So I clicked on a button to describe it and said in great condition. I looked over at the bid, still said $110. I'm still trying to figure out what's wrong with it. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying?
Amen.
I'm sitting there trying to find something wrong with it, and God is trying to bless me with it. He started when he made me late to get over to the salvage sale. It started when the devil had me going back and forth. We got the red van, we got the trailer, and we bumping along back and forth down Parham Road. It was way back there. He had it set up that guy no longer was busy, came over to me, and gave me the website. But I'm sitting at the computer because of the price is unbelievable. For a 24 by 36. Yeah. And the description says the heat works, the air works. There is nothing, the construction is good on this building. The only thing wrong is some tiles are missing on the floor. I'm flicking through the pictures, and I'm flicking, and I'm hearing the devil. You know you're gonna be disappointed again. I don't know why you even trying. I'm hearing this negativity. And what if you bid and you get it and it's a piece of junk? Here's fear. So there's a number there. I call a man. He said, well, I'm not the guy to tell you about it. You need to call this guy. So I called him. I got a machine. I'm being pounded by the enemy. With all the negativity that guy just spit out to the other guy, I'm being pounded with. Do you be anything that God, yeah, it's possible. Yeah, I'm hearing these things are happening every day. Yeah, you gotta believe all things are possible, but let's have some sense about it. How do you think you had to pay $35,000 for used ones that there's someone, come on. But I call and leave a message anyway. A little while later, he calls me, and I'm sitting with Captain Powers in my office. We're talking about Thanksgiving service and all. And I said, hello. Now, normally, if I'm in a meeting, I don't even answer the phone. Plus, I didn't remember I called him on cell. I thought I called him from the church phone, but I did call him from cell. So he says, hello. I said, hello. Because I'm like, I didn't check my caller. I think, who is this strange boy? He says, this is Mr. Nobles. Well, that was, I said, oh, Mr. Nobles. He said, let me tell you something. I'm on vacation in Alabama. But I got your message, and I'm answering you because you said you were a pastor and it was about your church school, and I'm a Christian. He told me, I'm telling you, structurally, this building is sound, and you might want to paint it. There's some tiles missing on the floor. That's it. He said, what's the last bit? So I told him what the last bit. He said, well, you know, in the beginning, I thought I'd get $2,000-$3,000 for this building. But this is the second time I'm running it through. And he said, I got to go ahead and get rid of this because I got 30 more I got to get rid of. Because Chesterfield is backlogged with mobile trailers they're not using, and I'm responsible for it. And I said, oh, I'm just listening, getting a little excited, but I'm listening. He said, so I tell you what, this is for the church. He said, if you put in a bid of $300, I'll take it. Those of you, Brother Shelton, Brother Andre, maybe Ezekiel, maybe David, Davis, I don't know. But that's a lot of room, 24 by 36. And I'm like, okay, here come the devil. Well, how you gonna move it? You probably gonna have to call Joyce at Mobile Solution, and you know she want $2,500 to move it. So how you gonna move it? So I said to him, I said, may I ask a question, Ms. Nolte? He said, sure. I said, and I apologize, I said, I'm so sorry to bother you on vacation. He said, you didn't bother me. I didn't have to call you back. So I said, well, how do we move them? He said, well, I'll tell you. And he got quiet for a minute. Here come the devil. He said, the reason I got this job and they put me in charge of this a few years ago is I had a mobile homes business for 16 years. I said, oh, really? He said, yes, so I know about these things. I said, oh. He said, and I still have my towing truck and all my equipment. He said, now I move them for people. He said, I usually charge a whole lot more than this. He said, but if you give me $500, I'll move it for you. $800 versus
$35,000. That's right. That's right. Thank
you. You gotta be confident that what God said he would do, he will do. Just hold your horses. Train. Bishop said something Sunday I really liked. He said a lot of like, but he said this and I remember. He said, train your brain. This thing will run 50 miles an hour. It will go while you sleep. It never sleeps. Your brain never rests.
That's right.
Never. If you don't start learning controlling thoughts, you will never have the confidence level even where I am. I realized I sat behind my desk and cried in Thanksgiving because I realized when he told us way back, he said, I'm going to give you all some space. And we've been working on this all spring, all summer.
Amen.
We hoped it would be all set up for the first day of school.
Amen.
And it didn't happen. I'm now into October. We could have took out a loan. We could have went into debt. But I was confident.
Yeah. Amen.
That was not how God wanted us to go.
That's right.
But I couldn't explain it to anybody. It's like going to drive time or one of these places or check and go. Because you just can't wait. And now you're in debt up to your yin yang. And then somebody comes on and says, you know what? I got this Altima and I don't even drive it no more. You want to buy it off of me for $1,000? What year is it? Oh, it's a 2008. A 2008 Altima is going to go for no less than 12 or 15 pounds.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. But God was going to give it to you. But see, we move ahead of God because of our emotions, our attitude. We woke up on the wrong side of it. That's why the Holy Spirit told me, don't open your mouth. Because he knew he had set us up. And I could have, in lack of confidence and faith, ain't nothing working. I don't have a desk, don't have no room, I don't have a camera, I don't know if we supposed to add on the back, I don't know what's, and now I can't even get no lousy $3 piece desk, ain't nothing. See, I knew that I would go there. And the Holy Ghost knew. So he said, don't open your mouth. He didn't say, don't open your mouth because I'm going to bless you. He wanted me to have confidence in him and just don't say nothing. Didn't seem fair. Didn't seem right. You could be right but wrong. You know, I could have blew all that stuff off out of my mouth. I'd have been telling the truth, but I'd still have been wrong. Is anybody understanding what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We didn't have a desk. Mm-hmm. And the site that we went on and got to get, we still didn't have no desk on it. It wasn't about no desk. He was going to bring the past what he promised back in this early, back in March. Right on schedule. But I had to show God that I trusted.
Amen.
I had to show God I had confidence. I had to show God that no matter what, I was going to do what he said. You can have courage or you can have fear, but you can't have both.
That's right.
You'll tell yourself you can, but you'll be lying.
Yeah.
And a lot of people that are normally here are not here, but this was for you guys.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, this was for you guys.
Yeah.
Go to how many are left. And we're almost finished. Faith and I'm confident that even if I die, I'm dying for my children will be free.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to find an excuse not to come and get the word. This word is important. This word is deep. This word builds confidence. Either you stand on God's word and wait on Him, or you fail every time. Jesus told them, He said, and He had 80 disciples, and He told them, and said, in 3 days, I'll die, and I'll come back. Everybody left. He got down to 12. He looked at Peter. He said, are you going to go too? And Peter said, where will I go? Only you have the gift of eternal life. That is what I say. Where will I go? Only God and His word have the answers for my life. Where else will I go? In the end, they come together. In the end, they die together. Believing, confident that what they are doing is worth something. What they are doing, they may never see what they're fighting for, but confident that grandchildren and great-great-grand us sitting in these seats will be free. They fight. The saints of old in the Old Testament died never having saw the promise the Bible said. The New Testament, He comes. And even there, they were killed and beaten. But they'd be chained to poles, set afire, singing, because they were confident. They were torn apart by elephants and lions. And as they put the chains on them, they were singing praise and worship songs because they were confident. This is for something. There's a reason. There's a reason. See, when it's not about you, that's love. That's unselfishness. They died crucified upside down. John the Baptist, his head was cut off. And they did it with confidence for us that were coming. Victory is not always in getting what you were after. The victory is in the confidence. Play the last one. Thank you, Jamie.
Any
much matter what happened to Mom. But the man ain't.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yes.
He's got his confidence. Why do it? You know you're gonna die. about you anymore. It's about the purpose God bless you for. You can do awesome things.
And carry on.
fighting for what they believe in. I wonder tonight what you're willing to die for. What you're willing to do what the 54th did. What makes you bold as a lion for God and not for yourself? See, you can't be in self and do that. They die never seeing the promise. And their children die and never saw the promise. But here we sit. We're the promise. We're not enslaved. We're free. Because someone had confidence. Somebody believed that this day would come. What do you believe? Stand to me.